Tantor Audio presents Think, Why You Should Question Everything by Guy P. Harrison. Narrated by George Newbern. Introduction. My life has been better because of a key decision I made many years ago. I'm not sure exactly when it happened or if it even occurred in a single moment, but somewhere along the way I decided to be a good skeptic and think like a scientist every day. This simple but crucial choice has saved me time, money, and probably a lot of embarrassment and regret, too. Who knows, it might have saved my life. I didn't take this path because I wanted to feel superior or look down on others for believing things that probably aren't true. Skepticism is not arrogance. I didn't make the decision because I wanted a cold and unemotional life devoid of mystery. Skepticism does not drain the joy from life. In fact, it can add much to it. Thinking like a scientist doesn't mean one can't enjoy fiction and fantasy and dream impossible dreams. Thinking skeptically certainly does not require one to deny or ignore the many unanswered questions all around us. I simply thought that it made sense to embrace skepticism because I wanted to minimize the amount of my life I wasted on lies, mistakes, and misperceptions. I also didn't want to run the risk of being a sucker or easy prey for con artists. If I hadn't been skeptical about every unusual and important claim that came along over the years, how many crackpot medical treatments might I have squandered my money on? Would one or some of them have harmed my health? It's impossible to know, but I'm glad I didn't risk it. How many smooth-talking crooks and seductive but worthless products failed to fool me? How many organizations based on lies or hopelessly dubious claims did I not join, thereby not wasting precious hours, days, and years of my life? How much stronger and more confident have I been when facing each new day because virtually all my fears and anxieties stop where known reality ends? I worry about those who are weak skeptics. I feel sad when I see people stumble. There shouldn't be so many victims. I believe anyone can think like a scientist, and everyone should want to. This book will show you how. If you are already a good skeptic, it can help make you a better one. It will also show you more effective ways in which you might spread the word among friends and family members who may be a little too loose with their beliefs. Thinking like a scientist doesn't guarantee anyone a perfect life that is without mistakes and free from danger, of course, but it does put you in the best possible position to successfully navigate your way through this crazy world of ours. Insufficient skepticism is perhaps the most unrecognized and underreported global crisis of all. Applied vigorously and consistently, skepticism could change humankind for the better overnight. It is our most neglected defense and underutilized weapon. Politicians never mention it. Teachers rarely teach it. Few parents encourage it. So, with little resistance, the world keeps spinning its lies and delusions generation after generation. The cost of leaving so many unproven claims and bogus beliefs unchallenged can be seen in diminished and lost lives. Most people underestimate how easy it is for healthy and bright people, including themselves, to be seduced by the irrational ideas of others or led to fantasy land by the natural processes of their own brains. One of the goals of this book is to make sure you don't make that mistake. This may be described as an instructional or educational book, I suppose, but it is very important for listeners to recognize that it is not a collection of facts or a presentation of arguments meant to instruct people on what to think. This book is about how to think. I'm not looking for loyal teammates or hoping to enlarge the choir that I preach to. I want to inspire listeners to think for themselves in sensible ways that allow them to chart their own course in life without being tripped up by one irrational belief after another. I absolutely do not want listeners to look at me as some voice of authority that they can rely on as a shortcut to their own thinking. For example, I don't think psychics and mediums can read minds and carry on two-way conversations with dead people. But don't take my word for it. Figure it out for yourself like a good skeptic would. I've been wrong before. Maybe I'm wrong about this. This book is a call for self-reliance. It's about you. In order to live in the real world and hopefully avoid becoming the pathetic plaything of crooks, kooks, and sincere but deluded people, you have to use and rely on your brain, no one else's. Sure, expert opinion and information from credible sources matter, but not nearly as much as your own ability to react wisely when an extraordinary claim knocks on your door. For your own sake, you need to know what to do so that you can determine whether or not you should let it in or slam the door shut. Have no doubt, there are an infinite number of weird claims, unusual ideas, dangerous ideas, and unlikely to be true beliefs stalking you every day. People make up new claims every day, so we can't possibly carry around in our heads tailored, preloaded responses for each one. A good skeptic is ready for all of them simply by knowing how to think critically and by understanding the wisdom in questioning everything. A good skeptic also needs to know basic facts about what the human brain needs in order to work well, because it all starts there. Researchers continue to accumulate evidence that show nutrition and physical activity are more important than we ever knew. When spreading the word about science and skepticism to others, it also helps to know a minimal amount of background information and alternate explanations for some of the more popular beliefs. This book will help with all that, too. Skepticism is an important issue for everyone. It's something we all need, regardless of intelligence, education, location, social status, or income. The mere fact that you have a human brain makes you extremely vulnerable to believing things that are not true. There's no escaping this. The natural processes and instincts we all have set us up to fall for things that are not true or real. It comes with being human. If you deny this and think you are immune, it only makes you more vulnerable to nonsense and delusion. Fortunately, the same brain that so often fails us and tricks us can also be very good at protecting us. It can be the most vigilant and effective guardian you could ever have. Or it can be a source of constant problems. It's up to you. Guy P. Harrison. Earth. Chapter 1. Standing Tall on a Fantasy-Prone Planet. Generally, I like to assume that it's not smart to generalize and make assumptions. Too many things fall somewhere into that broad abyss between black and white. Since you are listening to this book, however, I'm going to go out on a limb and make two guesses. One, I'm willing to bet that you are a human being, and two, you live on Earth. If I'm right, too bad for you. Whether or not you have realized it, your address and your membership to the human species have condemned you to a life sentence atop the crust of a spherical madhouse. Through no fault of your own, you have been born into a world teeming with good people who mean well, but to one degree or another are deranged, deluded, and just plain wrong. And most of them are eager to lure you into the fog with them. But wait, there's more. There is also no shortage of bad people who don't mean well. They trade in lies. Their goals may include harming you, exploiting you, taking your money, or all three. Unfortunately, you can't hide from any of these people. Some days, it's the dishonest ones who come for you, and other days, it's the sincere but mistaken ones. Sooner or later, they will find you. They always find you. In fact, many of them are in your life right now, no doubt. They live in your neighborhood. You go to school with them. You work with them. Sometimes they are close friends. Every family has at least a few. You could try to run, but to where? No place is safe because they are everywhere. No city, no society is free of them. Again and again, they will reach out to you. They have a million methods and a trillion techniques. Their ideas can be like microbial parasites, requiring only the smallest crack or opening to squirm in and take over your brain. Join us. Pay us. Give us your time. Buy this. Trust this cure. Pay us now, please. Think like us. Be one of us. Believe us. And don't forget to pay us. When they come for you, the easiest thing to do in the short term may be to hand over your brain or your wallet, and then march quietly into the swamp of muddy thinking like a good little drone. The long-term consequences for you may be harsh, however. Perhaps some people are so weak and so passive that assimilation really is their only option. Fortunately, this is not the case with you, I'm guessing. You would probably like to hold on to your brain, money, health, and dignity. Am I right? I wish this book were absolutely universal in appeal, but it might not be the best fit for everyone. Therefore, let's address a few basic points early to make sure that this book is right for you. If you like the idea of spending a lifetime stumbling back and forth between a variety of unproven claims and strange beliefs that are almost certainly not true, then stop listening to this book now. If you think it would be really cool to waste thousands of dollars over your lifetime on bogus miracle cures and absurd products hawked on infomercials, then you need to immediately put this book down and step away from it. If worrying about things that don't exist and cannot harm you sounds smart, then run as far away from this book as you can. Hurry, it might attack you. If being intellectually smothered within a group or organization that discourages thinking and forbids asking meaningful questions sounds comforting and reasonable, then buy as many copies of this book that you can afford, and then burn them all. As they are burning, be sure to chant something. The words don't matter. Anything will do. I'm sorry if you now feel that this book is not for you, but at least your path in life is clear. Trust everything anyone tells you. Live by a creed that says any claim that feels good and sounds good must be true. Forget reason and always go with your heart. Who needs facts when your gut speaks to you? Never second-guess anything. Never doubt. Never question. and never worry about things like evidence, proof, logic, or that obnoxious thing called science. That's it. You are ready to live a dream life. Before you begin your journey, however, please close this book and slam it against your forehead 10 times. This will give you good luck, trust me. Still here? Then it can only mean one thing. You are ready to think. You must be the kind of person who likes the idea of standing tall on Planet Crazy with eyes wide open and a revved-up thinking machine just like a 21st-century human should. You want to be good at spotting scams and recognizing worthless products for sale. You want the ability to see through hollow words and dishonest promises virtually every time. A safer and more efficient life sounds good to you. You are ready to put up a fight against all those barbarians at the gate who are determined to invade your skull. Their mission is to use and abuse you with counterfeit claims and fake philosophies, but you are going to be ready for them. Think like a scientist. The most effective antidote for bad thinking is good thinking. The best way to make con artists vanish is to see them. The best way to silence crazy claims is simply to listen to them with a sharp brain and then ask the right questions. It is important to look at wild claims and hear incredible sales pitches with deliberate effort. You can't be passive about this. Crooks and kooks love finding a brain with a wide-open doorway and nobody standing guard. Respond to extraordinary claims in a way that is similar, in spirit at least, to how a scientist would investigate a new exotic illness found in redwood trees or newly discovered microbial colonies in the belly buttons of Latvian fishermen. Observe, research, hypothesize, think up ideas, ask questions, experiment, and share your ideas and conclusions about it with sensible people. Rinse and repeat. Thinking like a scientist is not that difficult. Young children can do it. Old people can do it. High school dropouts can do it. It doesn't require you to memorize the periodic table of elements or to understand quantum physics. Thinking like a scientist in this context only means that you maintain a healthy level of curiosity and doubt. You aren't afraid to ask questions and request evidence, and you don't draw conclusions about things until you have very good reasons to do so. You also must be willing to change your mind if your conclusions turn out to be wrong. The bad news is that people with weird, unproven claims outnumber you. They may have popular opinion, tradition, and the always attractive lure of lazy thinking on their side. You may think common sense, the laws of nature, and logic would constrain these people, but they rarely burden themselves with such concerns because theirs is the domain of the make-believe, where rules are invented or discarded as desired. They might also cheat by appealing to emotion and tickling your soft underbelly. They might tell you that their way is warm, comforting, exciting, and meaningful, while the skeptic's world is cold, lonely, boring, and empty. Don't believe such lies. Deciding to think like a scientist is the hard part. Doing it is fairly easy. The mechanics are simple and straightforward. Proof comes before belief. Nothing is ever beyond question or revision. Don't be fooled. This is a lifelong war, and every day is a battle. Irrational thinkers and their crazy claims never go away. You can never declare victory and let down your guard because there are always more nearby who are looking for another mind to infect. Dismantle one of these brain-snatching beliefs with your skepticism, and 10 more are ready and waiting to take its place. Annihilate one hollow claim with reason, and 20 more rise up. The best you can do is hold them off in a siege that never ends. And through it all, you need to stay positive to hold on to your humanity. You can't allow yourself to become frustrated and bitter and begin to pull away from your fellow humans. That's not good for you and not good for the world. Excluding the liars and the con artists, people who believe in bad ideas are victims of bad thinking, that's all. Despising them or giving up on them is not constructive. I've been promoting and writing about skepticism for many years, and I have dealt with some of the most idiotic and depraved lunacy imaginable, and yet I can still say without hesitation that I love people. They frustrate me and disappoint me to no end, but I still love them. Halfway home. Now for some great news. You are already a skeptic and a critical thinker. You're halfway there. Whether or not you recognize it, you apply skepticism and critical thinking skills every day. We all do, because everyone is a skeptic to some degree. Think about it. Nobody believes everything. For example, if some guy tries to sell you a candy bar that has already been opened and you don't recognize the logo on the wrapper, you probably wouldn't just do the deal and start chewing without giving it some thought. Even if he promises you that it is one of the best-tasting candy bars in the world by far, and he's offering you a super special once-in-a-lifetime price, you aren't going to bite on the deal or the candy bar without first doing some critical thinking, right? Even if he further tempts you by adding that it has special probiotic homeopathic properties guaranteed to detox and revitalize your spleen, you still would likely hesitate. you would assess the claim that it's a great candy bar. Then why haven't I ever heard of it? You would try your best to analyze the condition of it. It's open. How do I know a used candy bar is safe to eat? The phrase, too good to be true, might come to mind. You would wonder about the claims he made. What in the heck does probiotic homeopathic mean, and why does my spleen need revitalizing anyway? You probably also would consider anything you know about the seller's character and reputation. What do I know about this guy? Is he honest and reliable? Is he an expert on spleens? Did any of his former customers die of food poisoning? Regardless of who you are and how desperate for candy you may be at that moment, you are likely to ask a few direct questions about the candy bar's appearance, mysterious brand, low price, and medicinal properties before buying it. Even if you were desperately hungry, you probably would request a small sample of the candy bar for a quick sniff or taste experiment. See, you're a skeptic. You think like a scientist. But it's not enough to reserve your skeptical powers for encounters with suspicious candy bars only. None of us automatically believe, accept, or buy every story, claim, and product that comes along. We think. We ask questions. We routinely use our brains to protect us from making bad decisions and allowing ourselves to be misled by incorrect information and outright lies. This is skepticism in action. But while virtually everyone may become a world-class skeptic when faced with a stranger who wants to sell some funky candy, what happens when a trusted friend tells you that she saw a ghost, says she had a horoscope hit right on the mark, or asks you to buy memberships in a group that promises personal peace and financial wealth? How would you react when an authority figure, someone you may have looked up to for years, insists that they have just the medicine you need to feel better? It's only $99.99, and it's natural, so it can't possibly hurt you, he says. Are you a world-class skeptic during moments like these, too? Or does something cause you to dial it down? This is what happens for most people. They wouldn't buy a used bike without inspecting every inch of it and test riding it. But they might buy into 100 different outrageous claims without blinking based on little more than feeling or a friend's word. It happens every day, but why? Why wouldn't you want to be skeptical about everything, not just from candy bars to bikes, but from healthcare products to horoscopes and beyond? Skepticism is too reliable and too valuable to leave on the shelf. Use it everywhere and every day. Wait, what is skepticism? Before we get too far down this road, let's make sure we know what skepticism is. Skepticism and science are really the same thing and work pretty much the same way. Skepticism is just about having a healthy dose of doubt and using reason to figure out what is probably real from what is probably not real. It means not believing you know something before you can prove it, or at least make a very good case for it. Skepticism is nothing more than thinking and withholding belief until enough evidence has been presented. It also means keeping an open mind and being ready and able to change your mind when new and better evidence demands it. Proven doesn't mean forever. A good skeptic thinks about the source of a claim and how well it ties in with what we already know about nature and people, and most important, a good skeptic resists the temptation to make up answers to important questions. Saying, "I don't know," is not uncomfortable for a good skeptic. It's routine. I think of skepticism as science in action. It's the scientific process modified and personalized for everyone to use in everyday life. Why should professional scientists be the only people who get to think straight? We civilians have just as much a right to use rational thinking as they do. I imagine my own skepticism to be something like a personal force field that protects me from invaders. It's like a balled-up fist that punches out bad ideas, aiming to do me harm. Who wouldn't want that? If your skepticism force field is powered up and calibrated correctly, then the crooks, time wasters, crackpots, and creeps who want you to join their crazy clubs or buy their junk tend to bounce right off. Sometimes it's dramatic, and they get torched like a fly nose-diving into one of those electrified bug whackers. Most of the time, however, you barely even notice their failed attempts because they are so weak and silly. But if your skeptical force field happens to be weak or turned off from time to time, it can be a very different story. The infiltrators will slip right in and proceed to infect you with their nonsense. Don't miss the seriousness of this. The quality, strength, and consistency of your skeptical thinking will likely have a direct impact on your safety, success, and quality of life. Doing your best to stay free and clear from bad ideas and bad people who would take advantage of you should be a top priority. We may not have to worry about giant prehistoric cats eating us anymore, but that doesn't mean there aren't plenty of other predators looking for you. Your skepticism can also be either purely selfish or strictly humanitarian in nature. It's up to you. But either way, skepticism is the wise choice. If one wants to make the world better, safer, and smarter, skeptical thinking is the way to go. Why should me-first divas waste 1 second of their days on nonsense beliefs when it would mean less time to be selfish and self-centered? Become a good skeptic for the betterment of our species, or do it for yourself and to hell with the world. Just make sure you do it. If you aren't sure which camp you belong in, don't worry. Most good skeptics probably have a bit of both in them. I know I do. No off days. Being a consistent skeptic can be the difference between life and death. The moment we let down our guard is when bad things come rushing in. Ceasing to think independently, analyze relentlessly, and ask the relevant questions is a big fat green light for bogus beliefs to raid your inner sanctum. Don't underestimate the importance of this. It's tempting to dismiss the threat of bad beliefs as nothing more than fringe silliness about silly people, nothing much to do with you. But this is deadly serious, and none of us are ever in the clear thanks to the brains we are blessed and cursed with. For lack of skepticism and ignorance about how the human brain misleads its host, many millions of people suffer needlessly every day. Millions throw away money on garbage ideas and rip-off products. Millions sacrifice irretrievable hours, days, and years of their lives on hollow claims. As we will hear later in this book, many people die prematurely as a result of their weak or inconsistent skepticism. Sadly, most people turn off their skepticism at the very times they need it most. Everyone may be skeptical to some degree, but the unfortunate reality is that most people are just not on their toes when it counts. All they probably need is a minimal amount of knowledge about critical thinking and a little encouragement to live more reason-based lives. This is why I write books like this. It's why I do all I can to promote science and reason. For me, it's a moral issue, and a big one at that. I can't look at all the madness and suffering that comes from weak skepticism and do nothing about it. This is a gigantic problem that doesn't get the attention it should. For example, you aren't likely to see many, if any, big media news reports on the global cost of gullibility, or how much violence, poverty, and death is tied to the failure of the world's families and schools to produce critical thinkers. Nonetheless, whether or not we acknowledge it, the kind of weak and inconsistent skepticism that is typical of people today is a massive drain on humanity and a constant source of suffering. It hurts countless individuals while simultaneously slowing progress and undermining prosperity for all, yet it is unrecognized and unspoken of by virtually everyone everywhere. I promise that if you invest the time to listen to this book and apply what you learn, you will have a huge advantage over the majority of people in the world. You can be a leader rather than a follower. While others are tripping over their own feet in the dark while looking for ghosts and monsters that they will never find, you can focus on getting real things done. You can make genuine discoveries and perhaps find everything you need to build a good life for yourself right here in the real universe. You can choose to spend your money on things that actually exist, make sense, and work. Unburdened by the weight of too many delusions, you can devote more time and energy to family and friends or helping strangers in need. As a good skeptic, you are in a better position to utilize the benefits of science and scientific thinking to help you make the most of your life. It's free and simple to decide to embrace skepticism, but the payoff is huge. Who cares? So what? And why bother? We live in a wonderful age of awesome electronic gadgets, amazing medical science, and computers that get smaller and more powerful each year. There is even a space station flying above our heads at a speed of more than 17,000 miles per hour. It has been continually occupied by humans for more than a decade. It's the tiniest of footholds, but we can honestly say that our species lives on Earth and in space. We are mapping the genomes of plants and animals, mapping our brain, exploring Mars with robots, and learning more about the vast microbial universe all around us every day. I'm sure you already knew all about that cool stuff, of course, but did you also know that thousands of witches are banished from their homes and tortured, and some are killed each year? It's true. In the age of science, millions of us still cling to the same irrational fear of spells and hexes that have haunted us since we first made them up. We may have left the Stone Age, but the Stone Age is still in us. Psychology professor Hank Davis has an excellent book about this problem called Caveman Logic, The Persistence of Primitive Thinking in a Modern World. He's right. Prehistoric thinking remains alive and well in the 21st century. If you are skeptical enough to know better than to be afraid of a witch, resist the urge to giggle here because there is nothing funny about this. This fear of magic and invisible demons that swirls around inside the heads of weak skeptics leads some of them to murder. Child witches in Africa, for example, are ostracized, beaten, starved, and killed by Christians who say they are only doing what their God demands. Reportedly, it is common for mobs to beat and kill witches and sorcerers in rural India. People should not be murdered for having extraordinary powers that no one has ever been able to reliably demonstrate or to prove exist in the first place. And people should not ever become murderers because they didn't hear that it's always best to think before believing. Far more deadly and widespread than witch persecution in Africa and Asia. Weak skepticism leads to suffering and/or death for unknown numbers of people everywhere who trust in medical quackery over evidence-based medicine. There can be no doubt that many hundreds of millions of people have suffered or died too soon because they weren't skeptical enough when it came to their personal health care or that of their children. It's impossible to know how much money people have wasted on bad beliefs and highly questionable claims in the last year, decade, or century. Whatever it is, I suspect it would be measured in the trillions of dollars. I have always found it odd that so many people in general are worried about money and eager to get as much of it as they can, yet they give it up so easily to nonsense. The greatest show in the universe. Before we go any deeper into what being a good skeptic is all about, let's make sure that one important point is perfectly clear. The kind of skepticism I am promoting in this book is positive, constructive, and optimistic. In my opinion, good skeptics gain far more than they lose. The kind of good skeptic that I hope you will consider becoming and encourage others to become doesn't have to sacrifice excitement and accept a less thrilling life. Sure, believing in unproven claims such as the Bermuda Triangle, Bigfoot, UFOs, and psychics can be a fun ride, but those trips are dull dead ends compared to what reality offers. Astrology can't compete with astronomy. Not even close. One only has to give skepticism and science a chance to find out. Unproven ESP claims pale in comparison with some of the things that cutting-edge brain science is discovering and doing these days. While charlatans claim to bend spoons with their minds, science actually moves robotic limbs with brain impulses. Looking up and hoping for a flying saucer full of aliens to fly by might be fun for a while, but the scientific search for extraterrestrial life gets more exciting with each passing year as technology improves, and we discover more planets that might harbor life. Look back at history. What did magic and monsters achieve? Science and reality do something all those supernatural and paranormal promises never do. Science and reality deliver the goods. Skepticism is negative? Ridiculous. If anyone near you suggests that, move away from them so you don't catch whatever it is they are suffering from. Skepticism is the brain's perfect diet. It trims away the fat and turns you into a lean thinking machine. It dumps unnecessary ballast and clears the way ahead so that you can get to all the good stuff out there, waiting to be discovered. Skepticism frees us so we can dedicate ourselves to real things and real people. Anyone who tries to tell you that skeptics are pessimistic party poopers or that the scientific process is dull and takes the thrill out of life has no idea what they are talking about. Help them see the light if you can. Just don't let them drag you down. The scientific process helps us to discover amazing things about the universe and ourselves every day. One can either be a good skeptic and appreciate science or stumble through life with closed eyes, missing the greatest show ever. This has never been more important than it is today because one risks missing out on more than all the people who ever lived before. Think about someone in the year 10,000 BCE who was determined to think magically and refused or had no interest in discovering much about the world and the universe as it really is. That person's attitude wouldn't have cost them much because relatively little knowledge was available anyway. Science as a formalized process didn't even exist then. No microscopes, no telescopes, no books documenting and explaining centuries of scientific discovery. However, a person who ignores or rejects science in our time turns her back on a staggering amount of important and exciting information. So much is known and so much more is sure to be discovered in your lifetime. Don't miss it because you were too distracted by a bunch of myths and fantasies masquerading as reality. The deeper you dive into it, the more you realize that science is much more freaky, amazing, wonderful, and important than all that supernatural and paranormal stuff could ever be. Why settle for wild claims that are not supported by good evidence when science has already confirmed so many other wild ideas? Millions of people say that paranormal mind powers can move objects. Big deal. People can say anything. Let's wait until someone gets around to proving it before we get excited. In the meantime, why not check out how nature moves entire continents? It's called plate tectonics, and scientists have plenty of evidence for it. You can follow the efforts of cryptozoologists with bated breath when they go looking for the Loch Ness Monster, or you can focus your attention on scientists who actually find new life forms all the time. There are probably 100 million species out there waiting to be discovered and named. After that, we have to figure out what they do, how they do it, and where they fit into the big picture. There is work to be done, large and small. We have only just begun to scratch the surface of the universe, and there is still much more to learn about the atom. Who has time for magic, myths, and lies? Are you into ghosts? Do you think they are real and important enough to occupy some portion of your mental energy? If not, you probably know someone who is a ghost enthusiast. People who believe in floating, semi-translucent dead people certainly should be free to do so, but for their own sakes, I wish they would give science a chance. I never tell people not to believe in things. For me, the old bait-and-switch technique is both gentle and effective. I don't mind listening to someone's ghost stories for a while. I might even share my own haunted house story. See Chapter 3. But somewhere in the conversation, I'll try my best to interest them in science, in reality. For example, why not upgrade from the ghost thing and look into the more likely possibility of parallel universes? It's not conclusive, of course, but there really could be other universes that contain identical or similar versions of you. There may be beings who inhabit other universes and other dimensions who are right next to you right now. Maybe one of them just walked through you. Isn't this possibility freaky enough for anyone's taste? One can also stretch their brain a bit by learning the basics about the structure and behavior of atoms. Reality gets very, very strange at the atomic level. For example, thanks to science, we know that all matter, including us, is mostly empty space. We are far from the solid beings we naturally imagine ourselves to be. Hey, maybe we are the ghosts. The nucleus, middle part, accounts for almost all of an atom's matter, solid part, but the nucleus is very tiny compared with the size of the entire atom. If one atom were enlarged to the size of an entire football stadium, for example, the nucleus would be about the size of a golf ball or a marble in the center of the field. The outer electrons would be orbiting way out in the cheap seats. So, back to you, if all the empty space was squeezed out of your body, then you and condensed you would be smaller than a grain of rice. Though it would be a very dense and heavy grain of rice. This means, of course, that the next time someone calls you an airhead, you shouldn't be offended, but should instead compliment them on their knowledge of atomic structure. But wait, we're not finished. Scientists are now figuring out that all this empty space in us and throughout the universe may not be so empty after all. Turns out there seems to be something in nothing. See, not only does science answer questions better than anything else does, it also generates new questions better than anything else does. Is it reasonable to conclude at this time that alien spaceships have visited the Earth? No, because although it could be true, the best anyone has ever produced to back up this claim are unreliable eyewitness accounts, stories of close encounters and questionable photos, videos of weird things in the sky. But being skeptical of UFO stories does not mean one can't give serious thought to the possibility of intelligent extraterrestrial life existing somewhere out there. The scientific process has led us to understand how adaptive and persistent life can be here on our planet. That knowledge, coupled with the immense number of opportunities for life that exist in a very large universe, gives us reasonable cause for heightened interest, if not outright enthusiasm. The absence of good evidence means that believing in aliens down here doesn't make sense, but thinking about aliens out there does. The skeptical outlook is not a negative mindset, as some who promote unproven claims would have you believe. Being a skeptic doesn't mean never getting excited about extraordinary claims or dreaming of grand possibilities. Hoping and having wild dreams are natural and healthy. A good skeptic only tries to balance it all with logic and evidence. If I'm being interviewed on some radio show and alien abductions come up, my first reaction is not to snap at a host or caller for believing this unproven and unlikely claim. My immediate instinct is not to take away an unfounded belief from the brain of a bad skeptic. I'm more interested in giving them something better. So I quickly point out a few basic problems associated with the alien home invasion claim, and then go on to spend as much time as they will allow me to teach something about space exploration and the scientific search for extraterrestrial life. If they fall in love with that, maybe they won't be so impressed with hollow stories. Hate the belief, love the believer. I always try my best to separate the beliefs from the believers. One can sometimes become frustrated with someone who believes a nonsense claim, especially if it's a destructive belief. But I try to keep in mind that it's the claim that I'm upset with and not the person. When someone gets cancer, you don't get mad at the person, you get mad at the disease, right? In my opinion, good skeptics should avoid being too harsh with people who believe silly things. Be less condemning and more understanding. Teach, don't shout. After all, we've all been there in one way or another, and at one time or another. When I was a kid, I believed briefly in the ridiculous claim that superintelligent aliens visited the Earth long ago and showed our mentally deficient ancestors how to paint on cave walls, build pyramids, brush their teeth, and so on. I'm not proud of it, but I'm not ashamed of it either. I'm human. Such stumbles come with the territory. Like good people, good skeptics care about others and want to offer a helping hand when and where possible. Whether the topic is Atlantis, reincarnation, or conspiracy theories, my goal is to enlighten people, to show them how easy it is for all of us to fall for a good story delivered by a confident storyteller. Simply being a human being and thinking the way we do sets us up to believe these things. I care about the world, so I try to make it less goofy and less dangerous by showing others how they can keep their guard up. Sensible people don't want idiotic ideas wasting valuable space in their heads if they can avoid it. The problem is that they need help to become good at recognizing idiotic ideas when they come along dressed up as perfectly reasonable and respectable claims. If you are not already, when you become a good skeptic, you can help others spot the nonsense too. Simply by spreading skepticism, you can help make the world better, and that's a beautiful thing. The Young Thinker. When it comes to adopting a skeptical attitude, now is better than soon. Don't delay in boarding this train. Start getting into the habit of thinking more critically about weird claims and beliefs immediately. Starting today, ask questions and demand evidence before you let yourself accept something unusual or important as true. Being young doesn't matter. A life is no less valuable and precious in the early stages than it is in the middle and later stages. If you're young, don't wait to think straight and think for yourself, because it's never okay to waste time and energy on nonsense. Old or young, you want to squeeze everything you can from every moment. Learn, create, explore, have fun with friends, love your family, and all that. Don't sacrifice your precious days on somebody else's weird and unproven ideas. Think early and think forever. Why wouldn't you want to? Sure, depending on age and maturity, young people have to trust the older authority figures around them and accept that their own lack of experience means they aren't ready to go it alone. But that doesn't mean young people can't think for themselves to a significant degree, beginning right now. If you are a child or a teenager, do not accept that you are a robot to be programmed entirely by adults. Adults are often wrong. And you have in your possession a powerful brain. Use it. And if you're an adult, don't think it's ever too late to change the way you think. The sooner you can start thinking skeptically, the better. We are all greatly influenced by our family, friends, and culture, of course. But we can still make the important decision to think independently and respect ourselves enough not to blindly accept everything that the rest of the world tries to shovel into our brains. It's understandable that some young people might feel that skeptical thinking is disrespectful in some circumstances, particularly when it comes up against the beliefs or claims of beloved authority figures, such as good parents and favorite teachers. That often happens, of course, so it's a reasonable concern. But keep in mind that there is one form of respect that is even more important than the respect granted to authority figures. It's called self-respect, and thinking skeptically is the highest form of self-respect because it means you care about the quality of thoughts and beliefs that inhabit your brain. More than anything, this defines you. Your thoughts and your beliefs determine who you are and who you will be. The fact is, people in your life may be smart, love you, want only what's best for you, and still be completely wrong about some things. If current circumstances make openly questioning certain claims and beliefs too uncomfortable or dangerous for you, then don't do it openly, but do it privately. Being a good skeptic and thinking freely while keeping your mouth shut is infinitely better than not thinking at all. It may feel lonely at times, but it can be done. No one can know your private thoughts if you don't share them, not even a psychic. Take responsibility for your own brain. Good parents, teachers, and role models are quick to lecture young people about the importance of hard work, education, good manners, not breaking the laws, avoiding drug and alcohol abuse, safe driving, being honest, and so on. But how many take the time to explain the importance of skepticism? How many fathers sit with their daughters and teach them how to intellectually burn down the hollow claims of mediums, medical quacks, and astrologers? How many mothers make time to explain to their sons that the normal, everyday workings of the human brain can lead us astray when we try to separate reality from illusion and delusion? Unfortunately, most children grow up and enter adulthood unprepared for what they will face in the form of pseudoscience, false science, unproven claims that aren't worthy of acceptance, and just plain lies. I'm not bashing parents or teachers. Those are difficult and important jobs. I know because I have been a teacher, and I am a parent. Besides, in most cases, it's not entirely the parents' fault, because they probably never had anyone explain any of this to them when they were growing up, so they don't recognize the need or even know how to teach good thinking skills. Teachers may be hindered from encouraging skeptical thinking because they are often not allowed to deviate from some master plan that demands memorization and regurgitation exclusively from students. If you are a young person, the bottom line is that thinking like a scientist every day is so important to your chances of having a safe, productive, and fun-filled life that you can't afford to sit back and rely on a parent, a teacher, or some other adult to fill you in on skepticism at some point. That lesson may never be delivered. Encouragement may never come your way, so take care of your own business. It's your life. Live it wisely. Commit to skeptical thinking and try your best not to waste a single precious moment on lies and irrational dead ends. Sure, you will make mistakes. You will believe a few stupid things along the way. It's inevitable. And even the best skeptics have. But try your best to keep those missteps to a minimum. The Daily Grind. Listening to this book is a good start on the path to constructive skepticism, but it's only a start. You have to live it every day. It needs to become habitual, your instinctive way of thinking and reacting to the world around you. Do this and you will spend the rest of your life in a much better place from which to thrive. Never forget, your brain belongs to you. It is the one asset that has immeasurable value. It's way more precious than a cool car or a flashy piece of jewelry. Make your brain work for you and not against you. Learn as much as you can about how it operates. This book will help, but it's your lifetime duty to keep learning. Understand and never forget that a brain weak on critical thinking skills is more likely to trip you up again and again in life. Sadly, if your brain is not a top-notch reason machine, most of the time you won't even realize that you were a victim. You'll be falling when you think you're standing and shuffling backward when you think you are moving forward. Try your best to turn your brain into a formidable warrior, one capable of standing guard over you every waking minute of your life. Fantasy and fiction are okay. Never think that being a good skeptic means one has to be anti-fantasy, hate fiction, and generally steer clear of anything that might be interpreted as make-believe. Skepticism is not opposed to things that do not exist, only to false advertising that says the fake is real. Fiction is great. Make-believe stories are wonderful. I would hate to live in a world that had no creative tales to brighten the nights and spark us to dream about what might lie over the horizon and beyond the next century. Storytelling and story listening are big parts of being human. Made-up stories bind us together and help us to learn important things. The best fantasy and science fiction writers seamlessly mix fiction with nonfiction to magnify ideas and lessons, making them memorable. Great stories drive us to imagine reality in new ways and then inspire us to make it so. Scary stories are mental theme park rides that thrill us and tickle the deepest recesses of our brains to make us feel more alive. Skepticism is not a threat or an obstacle to any of this. I'm a hardcore skeptic and I love science fiction books and films. When I close my eyes, I see a time machine in my garage and Terminator robots chasing people in the streets. I have visited 100 planets and fought 1,000 monsters in my head. There is no contradiction here. I know many good skeptics who are neck-deep in the fantasy worlds of novels, films, or video games. It's only a concern when people confuse the fantasy for reality. As long as you can see where one world ends and the other begins, there is no problem. Science versus superstition. We all have a choice to make about how we want to live our lives and how we want to think about all the things we will encounter over the years. Do we intend to lean toward the supernatural, paranormal stuff and relax our skepticism, or do we want to go with science and keep it as real as possible? It's not always one or the other, of course. Many people jump back and forth between the two. I would argue, however, that it doesn't make sense to be science-minded one day and superstitious the next. Pick a team. If the scientific method is the best way we have to figure out what is real, and if you agree that being aligned with truth and reality is wise, then why would you ever want to leave that path? I suggest you make up your mind which way will serve you best and then commit to it. So, which way is for you? Science or magic? Astronomy or astrology? Alternative medicine or medical science? Microbes or monsters? Crystals or quarks? Choosing between evidence-based science and faith-based magic shouldn't be too difficult. Don't overthink it. Just ask yourself the following. Which one does the best job of paying off in useful ways for you? Which one is more reliable? And which one has the better record of success? Maybe the simple thought experiments below can help you decide. You need to communicate with your grandmother urgently, but she lives 2,000 miles away. What do? Do you close your eyes and begin chanting grandma's name in the hopes of establishing a psychic connection? Or do you simply call her on a piece of technology produced by science?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.